We'll hear argument in 21-874, American Campus Communities versus Perry.
May it please the court, Ms. Anderson will present argument for the petitioners. Petitioners have reserved 5 minutes for rebuttal.
Good morning. May it please the court. Petitioner Landlords seeks this court's guidance on an important question of Texas jurisprudence. In deciding whether or not to grant class certification, is it necessary for the trial court to determine the elements of the cause of action to be certified and tried? Texas Rule of Civil Procedure 42, CD1, answers this question directly. Quote, an order granting or denying certification under Rule 42, B3, must state the elements of each claim or defense asserted in the pleadings. Yet both the lower court and the Court of Appeals concluded that it was an improper merits question to determine the elements of the property code sections at issue here. How then do courts determine which inquiries are improper merits and which are important for predominance? In Bernal, this court addressed the scope of proper predominance inquiries, holding, quote, going beyond the pleadings is necessary, as a court must understand the claims, defenses, relevant facts, and applicable substantive law in order to make a meaningful determination of the certification issues. This court further defined predominance with reference to, quote, how the claims can and will be tried. In other words, the lower court need not resolve every legal question, but needs to resolve enough questions to know whether common issues will predominate and how the trial will ultimately proceed.
Is that a question we can reach before we address the standing issue you raised?
I think, Your Honor, that they sort of go hand in hand, but I would agree, Your Honor, that the standing is probably the preliminary question to answer. Whether or not the absent class members need to have standing.
How about the class representatives? Do you concede that they have standing?
Your Honor, I would concede that one of the class representatives has standing. Cliff Berry has alleged that there were some damages that she suffered as a result of conditions that were not adequately repaired. It's a little less clear about Ms. Spirer. She also alleges that there might have been some conditions, but they both admitted that there were no damages. But as to the absent class members, the issue with respect to standing is not just whether or not in the class certification context the plaintiff needs to prove standing for absent class members. We know that there's case law on that. The question here is whether or not it matters that the absent class members admittedly don't have standing, which is to say none of the absent class members are injured here.
So that does our case law require injury?
In general, Your Honor.
What about our old cases like Spence versus Finchler that said the legislature can authorize private litigants to sue under a statute authorizing any citizen to bring an action to enjoin the operation of a body house? And Scott versus Board of Adjustment, citing that, it seems like there's a tension in our case law, frankly, between adopting Article 3 standing requirements about requiring injury with these older cases that say that the legislature can confer standing by statute. Y'all haven't really briefed that fully, but it seems like your argument implicates that.
I would agree, Your Honor, that I haven't briefed it. But I think
but
there's...
But you raised the standing
I agree, Your Honor. I think there's two issues here. And I think the Ramirez case does a really great job of separating the two issues. The first is whether or not there's an authorized cause of action, and that's really what I was beginning with, which is to say.
No, and I understand, but what I was trying to figure out is, can we even get to that without grappling with all of the challenging issues that your standing argument raises because it's jurisdictional? And maybe there's a way that we can consider your argument on. What the elements of the cause of action is to be jurisdictional in some way that wouldn't require us to reach standing first, and that's why I was asking that question. Is there a way that we can consider that first, the issue about what the elements of the claim are? Maybe that implicates standing.
I mean, I think, Your Honor, the answer is it sort of does. I think there are two different inquiries, whether or not there even is a cause of action and whether or not there is standing. And I think if the court ultimately found that this was a completely improper class because the elements were not met, then that would eliminate the class. I think the court could address the issues in whatever order the court saw fit.
But we've said in Pike and other cases that not being able to prove your claim is a merits question, not a jurisdictional question.
I agree, Your Honor, that whether or not you could prove your claim ultimately is a merits question. The issue here is what are the elements of the claim. In other words, the plaintiffs contend that the elements of this claim, there are no elements, that essentially it's strict liability, and that's the end of the story.
And you filed a summary judgment on that, which hasn't been a potential file for permissive interlocutory appeal.
We did not, Your Honor. The summary judgment was actually filed and ruled upon before the class cert ruling. But as to the question about the underlying elements, that goes to what Your Honor is asking about, whether or not there is a cause of action. And that's what the Ramirez Court really distinguishes, that is that even if the legislature allows you to have a cause of action, you still need to have an underlying injury. Just because there's a cause of action.
So that following up on Justice Busby's questions, that if the issue on standing is whether the legislature can confer standing on somebody who isn't injured, that's the TransUnion issue. If you think about the standing issue that way, is there any need to answer that question if the legislature here has not attempted to confer standing on someone who isn't injured?
I would agree, Your Honor, that the answer to that question is no. That if you found that the legislature hasn't even really created a cause of action here, then you do not necessarily have to grapple with the standing question.
Failure of a cause of action isn't jurisdictional, is it? You know, it's Steel Co. and many other cases say that is itself a merits question.
Well, whether or not a cause of action exists is not a merits question, Your Honor. I would say whether or not a cause of action could ultimately be proven as a merits question, but whether or not it exists is not a merits question.
That's a jurisdictional question?
No, I think that's a predominance question, Your Honor.
So a 12B6 motion, for example, a motion to dismiss in federal court is jurisdictional. If you're saying you don't have a claim, I thought most federal courts said that was
No, I would agree that that's not jurisdictional, Your Honor.
Your point is that if this claim works the way they say it does, there is no standing.
Yes.
But if that conditional isn't true, there's no reason to address whether they have standing.
I would agree with that, Your Honor. Yes. Yes.
If there is a difference in perhaps the damages that would be awarded between class members who suffered a true injury where they sought repairs, they were not made, they materially affected the tenant's health and safety, versus a tenant whose injury or amount of damages may be lessened because the only injury that tenant could pursue is sort of the information injury. That they didn't receive the notice properly. Does that affect predominance inquiry, regardless of how that question is answered, whether there's a cause of action for that one group of people or not? Even assuming there is a cause of action for the failure to include that language in the lease, are the damages and the strength of the case so significantly different for those two groups of people that it's not appropriate to combine them in class?
Yes, Your Honor, I would agree with that. And I think that goes to why we would say predominance matters so much in this case. I mean, one of the arguments that the Court of Appeals made and one of the arguments that Respondent has made is this isn't a really big deal because the way the trial court has set up trial is there's going to be a trial on liability, and then we're going to go forward, and then we're going to prove if there's damages. And, hey, good news, petitioner, if we win,
and we have to prove all of these conditions precedent, then maybe there's not a class. I mean, the trial court talked about there could be individualized issues. In paragraph 40, the trial court
but
says...
But is it all right in sort of managing its case for the trial judge to say, look, the liability question is really the same, but the injury here is what is different?
No, Your Honor, and I think the reason that it's not okay is because predominance is not a numbers game. It's not about how many common issues do we have versus how many individualized issues we have. It's where is the majority of time going to be spent at trial. And if the majority of the time spent at trial is going to be spent on trying these underlying claims with all these repairs and underlying issues, then it's not a viable class. And that sort of issue, this certification of classes that could not survive, is something that this court has said was a problem when it's rejected the certify now, worry later approach. It's also obviously a problem for the defendants. The amicus sort of goes into this at great depth, that having a class certified, even a class that the defendants are confident has no merits, puts an incredible pressure on them to settle. And then, of course, it really does matter to the class. I mean, in this court's McAllen Medical Center versus Cortez decision, the court recognized that it's a problem where class members must decide whether or not to opt out of the class before it's been properly defined. So in the scenario that Your Honor just laid out, where we're not really sure whether we're trying an informational injury or are we trying whether or not they had the condition, the class members are not may not know that in advance based on the way the court has crafted this order. The court's order is that anyone's in the class who just happened to have a lease. So the class members don't know whether there's going to be something tried, that is, did you have a condition precedent? Was it properly repaired, or is the issue this whole informational injury thing? In the informational injury context, I do think it's important that, first of all, that's not something that has been recognized by this court. There are references in the federal cases to some sort of an informational injury. But also in the context of an informational injury, the type of damage that is, there is typically a discussion by the court of damage. The damage that the court is referring to in those cases is the injury that the statutes are designed to prevent, which again goes back to our argument here that the allegation here is that there wasn't language in the lease that informs you about what your remedies are if you've had this condition that materially impacts your physical health or safety if it's not time to repair. And we're talking about all former tenants that... And there's no allegation that any of them had this injury, that they didn't know how to make repairs. In fact, the named plaintiffs have all testified that during their time as tenants, they knew how to submit repairs and maintenance requests, that they were each given a resident handbook that had specific instructions on maintenance requests and emergency situations, and that the damages were repaired. Even while Barry and Spirer claim damages as a result of certain conditions to be repaired, Barry specifically testified that the condition did not materially affect her health or safety, and both Barry and Spirer testified that they notified ACC and ACC remedied those conditions. I also think it's important to note that this is not still a problem. As soon as ACC found out about this language that needed to be put in their lease, they added it to the lease.
I'm just trying to figure out. We're not supposed to decide your summary judgment because it's not before us. So what we've got to figure out is how does the way that the trial court resolved that summary judgment impact, has the court adequately thought through how that impacts the various class factors? And so you say it hasn't on predominance because the court's being inconsistent with the way it answered the liability on summary judgment. I'm not sure I'm understanding your argument.
No, Your Honor. I would say that the court did not in any way grapple with the elements of the cause of action for predominance and that it's required to do so under
even,
the rules
even
of
under the few of the elements that it took in ruling on the summary judgment.
Yes, Your Honor, because the ruling on the summary judgment was just a summary ruling. It's a summary denial. It just doesn't say that it's with prejudice.
Right, but the elements I assume would be consistent with whatever the trial court's ruling on summary judgment would be, and you're just saying the trial court didn't spell out what those were.
Yes, Your Honor.
Not that the elements would have been wrong if they were consistent with the summary judgment. I mean, I understand. understand that's your position on the summary judgment, but it doesn't seem like that can be your argument on the class certification.
No, Your Honor. If I'm understanding you correctly, the summary judgment ruling did not establish what the elements are. And our issue with the ruling on class certification is that there is no establishment of what the elements are. And the distinction between a statute that requires strict liability and a statute that requires you to prove that there was a condition that materially impacted the health or safety of an ordinary tenant that wasn't reasonably repaired, those are very different standards, and the trial in those matters is going to look extremely different. And that's why it's an important question that needs to be answered on predominance, and that it falls within the predominance inquiry and not within the merits inquiry. Now, we did try and get the issue resolved on summary judgment. Part of the interesting thing in this case is that at the time that we moved for summary judgment, the facts for summary judgment were very similar to the facts that we raised on class cert. And the reason for that is because at summary judgment, none of the plaintiffs were alleging injury. And I see that my time is out.
Any other questions? Thank you, Ms. Asher. We'll hear from the respondents.
May it please the court. Ms. Bell Stanton will present argument for the respondents.
Good morning, and may it please the court. I think it's important from the outset that we start with some critical concessions because it does really set the stage for the certification inquiry that's before the court. We know that there is standing for at least two of the named plaintiffs that have been designated and appointed as the class representatives. That is a concession that has been made. It would be contrary to all past precedent for this court to suddenly decide, well, it's okay for the named plaintiffs may have standing, but someday down the road there might be absent class members that will not, and make that a class certification decision.
But the reason they're conceding that the named plaintiffs have standing is because there are actually problems with their apartment that weren't resolved, or there was some physical issue with the repairs. And have you alleged that with respect to the absent class members?
Well, if I may divide the question out a little bit, Your Honor, to answer the question directly, we don't specifically say that there are property damages that are being raised by the absent class members. But that's not the only injury that we allege. The injury that we allege that directly affects every absent class member is whether the failure to provide the mandated disclosure language had far-reaching implications. The language of TransUnion versus Ramirez actually clarifies this. It doesn't strike against standing in this case. It says the test for the injury under a standing inquiry is whether there could be downstream consequences. We allege downstream consequences.
But if the named plaintiff's case is about repairs to their apartment, and the absent class member's case is about a lease provision not being in their lease, how do we have typicality and predominance between those claims?
Your Honor, as my colleague acknowledged earlier on, the allegations of the named plaintiffs have always been about the failure to disclose. They have identified specific injuries that they incurred as a result of the failure to disclose, but the cause of action has always been the absence of this disclosure language. There are two implications that come from that. There is the subsection A, all of the numbers start running together, so I kind of start labeling them. The tenant remedies section, judicial remedies section. Subsection A talks about violations of the repair duty and the available remedies. The duty. There's no question that there is a duty to have not only this language within the lease, but there is a duty to repair anything that's not specifically excluded or mandated. In fact, that's why we go back to subsection A of the Texas Property Code in section 92.006, the anti-labor provision. The tenant's remedies that we have alleged all along, not only as to the named plaintiffs, but also as to the class members, is this informational injury that says we know there is a duty. We know the landlord has a duty to repair. The landlord agrees they have a duty to repair. We know they also had a duty to disclose what must be done in order to protect the tenant's rights.
But one set of class members theoretically could show a causal link between the lack of the information and their injury. And another set of class members would not be able to show any causal link to any injury. And so does the difference in the proof and the ability to produce evidence of causation matter for considering predominance and typicality?
But not in this situation, Justice Bland. And the reason for that is because, again, even with subclasses, like in the TransUnion situation, where at the end of the day, some of the class members were entitled to recover because they met the proper standard and some were not. That didn't make class certification inappropriate. It made some class members not able to recover. But that's a decision on the merits.
Well, yes, and how would you know if you didn't try each claim?
You know, and Your Honor, that's actually an interesting question, because the whole theory is, how did we know, as the students, that we had to follow all of these additional steps in order to have a claim? I mean, this is a disclosure, an informational injury with downer consequences.
But you say some might be able to recover and some not. Don't you have to try every claim? And then how is it predominance and typicality?
Not every claim, Your Honor. Who gets to recover the damages? And if I may back up a little bit as to the trial plan and what the trial court was doing with the division and bifurcation of the issues. And it was to address that very issue, Justice Hecht. If we handle an issue certification, all parties agree, and I think this is an important point, all parties agree that the decision is that they want whatever the ultimate decision as the triggering event, what must be proven, those threshold liability questions, both sides want that to be certified. Both sides. They argue for it in their summary judgment. They wanted, if they won, they wanted their summary judgment to apply to the entire class. During certification, they argued that under a merits argument, that because they should win, then it should apply to everyone beyond the named plaintiffs. And in fact, even in this court, the Court of Appeals and before this court, they're arguing for a limitation of the class, not decertification of the entire class. And I think that's critical. They don't challenge the B2 certification. They don't challenge issues certification. They are before this court challenging a portion of the certification under Rule 42B3, but only once you get to the damages calculation. And Your Honors, again, that I agree with the phrasing of my colleague that it's not the number of issues. It's not a nose counting of the number of issues, but it's which issues predominate.
Their brief asks that the class certification order be vacated. So you said they don't actually want it all gone. So.
Well, there's definitely a conflict in their briefing. I realize that that's what the prayer says, but they also drop a footnote in their reply that says, we realize we didn't raise the issue of issue certification or B2 either in the Court of Appeals.
Just because they don't attack everything they could attack in the class certification order doesn't mean they don't want the whole thing called.
Well, and I'm sure that they would love the entire case to be done, because what they're actually arguing for is that there be no cause of action at all. But then
right,
they would.
So let me ask you about that. If as a purely statutory matter, I'm not talking about standing, but as a purely statutory matter, if we are of the view that the Supreme Code does not authorize lawsuits that are premised solely on the absence of this provision from a lease, do you lose?
No, but my class is much more limited. If
do you lose this class certification appeal?
It would have order as it's stated currently would have to be modified if this court determined that across the board there's a statutory right to pursue this. Now, as Your Honor also pointed out in cross-examining or asking questions of my colleague, there is a statutory right in place here, not only under subsection B in this disclosure requirement, but also under subsection A when we look at 92.006. So two different subsections. And the fact that the tenant's judicial remedies that we see in 92.0563 includes both a subsection B remedy, which would be under its A, and a subsection A remedy, which is under its little b. It's reversing them. So on those terms, we know the right exists. We know that there is a requirement. We know that the Texas legislature has replaced in restricted contract in the residential tenancy area.
Well, that laundry list of remedies, you know, things you can get, makes a lot of sense for claims about failure to repair. But it's more difficult to line up with what the remedies might be for failure to include a provision of penalties.
It does make it more difficult, but like the example in Spokio, it's not that intangible harms may be more difficult to consider in the context of standing when we're looking at the injury of the class action, predominance, not a standing inquiry. It would appear that those would be available while the tenant was still a tenant. If we were reading it that way, one of the options is to get the property remedied. But all, the entirety of the class was deprived of statutory disclosures, statutory requirements for their own recovery, and those remedies.
You think that somebody who was in the class who maybe would testify, I never read the lease and assigned it, never had a problem with the apartment, never issued a complaint, it was a wonderful experience, nonetheless, as a matter of law, would be able to recover these amounts?
No, Your Honor, they would not.
So then, as in response to the Chief Justice's question, is it the case that there will be people, if this proceeds, who you're going to have to go through and figure out, do they get to recover because they had some real-world harm that was caused by that absence of this language, versus those who had real-world harm but it wasn't caused by this language, versus those who didn't have any real-world harm at all and were going to have to sort through who gets any money?
Yes, Your Honor. We admit that we cast the net wide and that it narrowed down as we went through the certification process and then ultimately in the certification order. That's why the bifurcated issues preservation is so important, because we need to answer that question first.
Well, isn't it enough to say that in order to be typical of the absent class member's injury, the injuries of the named plaintiff have to kind of mirror those of the absent class members? And in the case of the named plaintiffs, you contend that it was beyond simply not having the provision of the lease. They actually encountered problems that effectuated this provision. And so why are their claims typical of the class that was certified? That includes all these people that potentially had no problem with the
plan. Your Honor, Haley Hoffenstein is a third named plaintiff who did not say that she had any condition that materially affected anything. She would represent those class members. She has alleged that hers is an informational injury only. In fact, in the testimony...
Did I hear you correctly in answer to Justice Young's question to say that those people with that purely informational injury who have a lovely apartment and never have any real problem other than the absence of this provision of the lease, those people cannot actually recover at the end of this case?
If we lose that argument, Your Honor, then they will not recover. I mean, that's the merits decision. Is
your position that they can recover?
Yes.
And if so, what?
In this case, we have statutory requirements that are statutory remedies, such as civil penalties, declarations.
Okay. So you are trying to recover on behalf of the people who loved their apartment and never had a problem, and the lease just didn't have every provision in it.
That is a claim that we are putting forward. But in answer to Justice Young's question, if we lose that, if if we lose at the informational injury or for some reason are not entitled to either the declaratory relief that we're seeking, either the waiver of defense issues that we're seeking, if we lose those on the merits, then there will be a section of people that...
Is Ms. Hoppenstein standing before us? She's a named plaintiff.
She is a named plaintiff.
Just said in the briefing, it's consistent with that. She's the one who, no problem. And it's almost like, oh, wow, this is fantastic. I get some money because there was this language in the lease that I never knew was supposed to be there and it wasn't there. This is great. I get a wonderful apartment and all this money. Is that essentially the...
That's in her deposition, Your Honor. She actually said, well, it's difficult to know what I don't know. Yes.
But how is she different from the TransUnion parties that had no real world harm and therefore would not have standing?
Well, Your Honor, it's difficult in TransUnion since that came after a trial on the merits. And so when the determination came down, all of these issues had already been resolved, and there was a section of people that, based on jury answers, based on findings, that...
So we have all that now with the named representative, Ms. Hoppenstein. So
from a standing.
So we know what TransUnion tells us about what it takes to have standing, and we know what she has.
Yes.
I'm trying to figure out how it's possible that if we... Maybe TransUnion is wrong, maybe Texas shouldn't follow it, but if we do, how is it possible that she would have standing to represent all the people in the class that are like her?
Your Honor, I think because if we do follow TransUnion and Ramirez, it's the court said as long as there could be an attributable downstream consequence.
Isn't that the point? There isn't. She didn't. What would the real world harm be to her that was caused by the lack of information? I mean, it's about fixing repairs. There were no repairs to be fixed. Well, could it possibly be?
Well, and that's when we go into the strict liability arguments that we have.
But that's just the informational harm. That's all that means, right? Isn't that what TransUnion rejected?
Well, we're saying that the failure to provide the disclosure itself constituted a waiver of unwaivable actions, and so it's a violation of both subsection B and subsection A on an informational, yes, Your Honor, on an informational level.
If I understand TransUnion to say you have to have more than that, you have to have something that's a real-world actual harm, something that's analogous to a common law claim, something that somebody could have done to you and you could recover from them. And if I think that what you're describing here is just in the air, the missing information that made no difference to anyone's actual life, what is there anything to it, or is it really just a debate about whether or not TransUnion complies?
Your Honor, if there was never any repair request at all, and they were happy and pleased, TransUnion would say they did not have standing.
Okay. And is that not Ms. Hoppenstein?
And that would be Ms. Hoppenstein. So that...
Hoppenstein, I'm sorry.
That would leave us with plaintiffs Barry and plaintiffs Spear, both of whom... But again, let me point out one thing with Ms. Hoppenstein. She actually did have repair requests. The question isn't whether she put in repair requests, it's whether she had additional property damage that derived from that. In the bench exhibits, there's a sample, I believe it's under tab.
Well, a repair request is not something that triggers the enforcement provisions, right? It has to be a condition that materially impacts the health or safety of a tenant and was not reasonably repaired. So there's the idea that things are going to break, right?
Yes, Your Honor.
And so, you know, given that you've got three named plaintiffs with diametrically different looking cases, have you all sought summary judgment?
This happened before. We could sit. In fact, in the trial plan, we proposed sending up competing summary judgments that actually go into statutory construction canons and going through all of this analysis as a part of the issue certification. Again, that's something that ACC wanted too, and that is let's get the statutory construction to the extent that anything beyond the plain language, obviously the students believe that the plain language is sufficient and there's no need to go beyond it. But even if we got into legislative intent, the very purpose of the disclosure addition was because Justice Bland that they didn't know, students didn't know that they only had X number of days to do something. They didn't know that they first had to give one kind of written request, and then later on wait, and then another.
But if everybody wanted that resolved, why don't we have a permissive interlocutory appeal on the summary judgment?
Certainly the students didn't want a permissive interlocutory appeal. We didn't have a summary judgment. We agree that the trial court made the correct decision, and that decision is the one that stands, and it stands with that there is a cause of action in place. And although the questions that the court's raising may ultimately come down to after the merits, is there a manageable way to handle what may be different damage models? Every named plaintiff, on behalf of every absent class member, asserts the same cause of action and the same harm.
So if the trial court's just dead wrong about how the law works and what the claim looks like, it's okay to just certify anyway and move forward and call it a merits issue, and it just doesn't matter that the trial court's wrong about whether this claim even exists?
Your Honor, if the trial court was wrong in granting a summary judgment, and that there was taking a position that could be reviewed. This is the procedural review under 42.
Well, about the summary judgment, the class certification entails a view of what the claim is. And if that view is just wrong in a fundamental way that undermines everything you're talking about, how can it be that we just put blinders on to the merits and affirm the class certification and send everybody off and wait for some later point in the case for it to be revealed that, you know, none of this makes any sense and the property code doesn't authorize any of it?
Your Honor, I see that I'm out of time.
That's my answer.
Thank you. The answer to that question is actually really simple in the context of, in this case, we don't have that in the but if we did, if we had a situation where the trial court was just absolutely wrong, that is still something that would happen in the merits. It's not that that decision is lost. The class certification mechanism is designed to handle these overarching issues. And at the end of the day, the only thing that's challenged is the B3 predominance class. And that is bifurcated to where we do not abuse the process. If there needs to be subclasses and some can recover and some can't, the trial court can handle it.
Any other questions? Just one more question. Yes. You're quite right that the other side has conceded standing for at least one of the class representatives, but that's jurisdictional, and so we can't rely on a concession. What I just want to make sure I'm understanding is what it is that for at least one of these class representatives is harm. It's not just in the nature of I had repairs or I was unsatisfied with the nature of the repair, but it was harm, real world harm that cost money or misery or whatever it was that was caused by the lack of this notice in the lease and not just a repair issue. What is that that you can
Yes, Your Honor, that is Brooke Berry. And, in fact, under the tab 6, you see emails, and she's also testified to it, where there was, whenever it would rain, that it would flood. And she would go weeks of sleeping on other people's couches, just being miserable, but also losing property, having this.
And all that harm was caused by the lack of the language as opposed to just the ordinary stuff that happens. And as Justice Blaine says, things happen.
Yes, Your Honor, it is caused specifically by the failure to have this information. In those emails, you see where they're asking for what is the remedy, what can we get some money back? And the answer is no.
Any other questions? Thank you, Counsel. Peterson, I believe you have 5 minutes.
Yes, thank you, Your Honor. Just a couple points of clarification. First, my opposing counsel raised the Section 92.0563B class, and that statute is slightly different. That is the anti-waiver prescription statute, which this court has, in fact, already said is only triggered if the landlord has a duty to repair or the tenant has a remedy under Subchapter B. So our view is that statute already says that you've got prerequisites. There has to be a repair. There has to be an existing something that you're going to be repairing before that subsection 92.0563B comes into place at all. But that is about the predominance issue. It's still the question of none of these class members claim injury as a result of those statutes. With respect to that question that that Your Honor was raising about the named plaintiffs, I would agree that Ms. Hoppenstein probably does not have standing. She has not alleged injuries as a result of anything. She doesn't have a claim. The named plaintiffs have a separate cause of action that they call the duty to repair. It's actually separate and distinct from these two statutes that they're claiming that they want certified on behalf of the class. They are not claiming injury on the statutes that they want on behalf of the class, except with a broad reading of the complaint as to Brooke Berry. The reason we didn't challenge that was, well, there's a couple of reasons. First of all, we sort of narrowed the issues that we brought before Your Honors. And secondly, with respect to Ms. Berry, I think you could read the complaint broadly enough to say that she is alleging some sort of injury as a result of this. And that's why we didn't raise that question.
If the only injury is the injury that arises from a failure to repair a material condition that affects the tenant's health and safety, what enforcement mechanism or what incentive do landlords have to include mandatory provisions in their lease agreements?
Well, Your Honor, I think that in this case, we don't necessarily need to answer the question of whether or not there is any enforcement mechanism available. I can say that at the moment, there's not a strict liability cause of action that of the type that the tenants are trying to raise here. Could a statutory violation be the basis for some other cause of action in Texas? Possibly.
Could it be that if there are deadlines or other requirements for the tenant to pursue remedies and the tenant misses those because they're not included in the lease, that the landlord couldn't avail itself of those sorts of defenses?
I think, Your Honor, that the situation that you're laying out would be a different section of the property code. So I think that if the landlord set up the lease such that the tenant didn't know about the underlying remedies, it could possibly be a violation of the anti-waiver provision, which is a claim. But there's not a separate cause of action for Section 92.056G. And the Texas legislature is presumed to know the law. And this court has said in the Brown versus Dela Cruz case that the court considered whether or not to apply a rule of necessary implication that when the legislative enforcement scheme fails to adequately protect intended beneficiaries, the courts must apply a private cause of action to effectuate the statutory purposes. The court rejected that approach and instead applies a rule of strict construction. So as Section 92.056G is structured, it is not a statute that allows for the type of strict liability that they're seeking here. But as I said, possibly it's a basis for some other claim, but it's not a claim.
Could there be enforcement by any government agency? Or that's one of the things in the federal cases, it's often the case is, well, yes, you can't get your $5,000 whatever, or maybe there isn't even a private right of action, but somebody in the government can, which doesn't have to show standing to enforce the law. Is there anything like that? That apartments, universities, figures, whatever could be subjected to in Texas?
I don't know if there's one specifically that would apply to that in this case, Your Honor.
I have a question. Let's say if you have a situation where one of the students or tenant was alleging that there were damages to their health and safety. Typically you would think that damage would be caused by the unrecovered defect, whether it be ceiling falling in or whatever. So can you think of a case where you could actually say that was caused by the lack of the provision within the lease?
No, Your Honor. That's actually one of the things that I've struggled with, is I can't see a pure informational injury here. It is not like the Atkins election case where I'm suing and I've got an informational injury in federal court because I need the information in order to make an educated voting decision.
So
that's my only way of getting the information.
So why does the statute exist?
Well, I think the statute exists to ask landlords to include it, which is why as soon as they found out that the statute existed, they did include it. But the legislature did not include a private right of action to enforce it.
Any other questions? Thank you, counsel. The case is submitted.
Thank you.
That concludes the argument scheduled for this morning.
All rise. Oyez, oyez, oyez. The Honorable, the Supreme Court of Texas now stands adjourned.